Hey, I'm Vance Martin, and I'm chairing the session. Eric will be presenting the paper. Just a couple of words I have about Mardi. Mardi and Eric wrote a very important paper published in the Journal of Applied Econometrics in 2018, very recently. But Eric's connection with Mardi actually goes a lot further back, and it happened. I was visiting ANU, working with Mardi's supervisor Adrian Pagan, and we were interested in this new technique called indirect inference, which of course Eric was one of the co-authors with Christian Guru and yes, thank you. I only really remembered your name. That same year, there was a PhD conference in the University of Western Australia. And I happened to be there, and there was a person presenting, which was Mardi Dungey, and she was presenting work from her PhD. And so she's looking at sort of factor models, but sort of very simple structures. And I suggested to her that maybe you should be looking at these latent factor structures, and one way of estimating these things was to use indirect inference. And so from that, Mardi invited me over to La Trobe, where she went. That was, her first job. And as Renee said before, we wrote a whole lot of papers on, mainly focusing on contagion, and that sort of work lasted for the next 20 years or so. So that's my connection. So it also means that Eric and I kind of had the same connection for the same length of time. You was more indirect initially, from an inference point of view, if I can tell that kind of joke. So, without any further say, please, Eric, can present.
Okay, thank you, Vance, for this introduction. So, let me try to find my slide. I guess I have just to focus on that.
Yes.
Right. So, I have chosen today to talk about econometrics function pricing with stochastic volatility. I put stochastic volatility on red because it is actually my first connection with Mardi, conformably to what you say to some extent. I would say it is my first connection. I would say maybe some of those connections we had after were even more important. I will never go to a bar without cooking scallops at Mardi's place, because for whatever reason, she appreciates my econometrics, but also my cooking. But of course, the friendship has been the most important thing. However, we started with stochastic volatility in the following way, so it is a kind of line, the story you mentioned. Because I met Mardi I don't remember, I think it was in Aix-en-Provence, and it was a conference, and we put together, and she told me precisely that she was working on contagion. I think she was, at the time you are writing this book, with people who are all in the room, right? René, Branda, and Vance. And just before that, I had written a paper on factor stochastic volatility in mean models. And talking together, I said to Mardi, it was the first time I was meeting her, but it seems to me that this factor, so basically once you say the same thing, I was not aware of that.
You should have talked.
I talked to Mardi, this factor stochastic volatility model should be a good tool to address your contagion issue. I did not know anything about contagion at this time. And this is the way we have written a paper together, basically applying my stuff for faster stochastic volatility to contagion issues. And needless to say, it has been a great experience to do that with Mardi and to keep, we have done, unfortunately, many of the things. And of course, as everybody, I was caught by surprise. She was actually visiting me just before the meeting. So Of course, it is a sad story, but this is the reason why I have shown up today to talk about stochastic volatility as a kind of my first common feature, I would say, with Mart. To do that, I will refer to two papers I have recently written with co-authors, mainly to the second one, but it's kind of a follow-up of the first one. The first one gives the framework, I would say. It is a focus on stochastic volatility, but with a special interest on the price of this risk. That is to say, the motivation is the following. There is a recent interest in the literature on the effect of stochastic volatility in asset prices. Of course, volatility has an impact on asset prices because risk is compensated, but what I'm talking about is an additional layer of risk, which is the risk on the volatility process itself, which is stochastic. And the people will have to be able to hedge the risk about volatility. So the real topic of interest, I should say, is more the volatility of volatility, right? And how it is priced. We know that the VIX market has to some extent been used to hedge this risk. And the VIX index is probably kind of option implied expectation. It is people, of course, have a lot of interest on understanding the price of this volatility risk on top of the price of the risk on the return. So there are two prices. And a popular tool for that is the so-called variance premium, where basically people make the difference between the risk neutral and the historical expectation of the coming variance. The intuition for that is that if you will be risk neutral, you have volatility, right? So typically, you expect this difference to be positive and to tell you something about how to price the risk in volatility. This measure of the price is popular for several reasons. Number one, as I said, this kind of this definition looks intuitive, right? Risk control and historical future variation. It is model free because it is based on derivative pricing because the VIX is based on derivative pricing. But it does not use a specific option pricing model. It is not that the VIX has a rational which is valid for any, I would say, diffusion model of volatility. So it does not depend on any specific option pricing model. It is model free. It can be observed directly because you observe the VIX. And you also observe the historical dynamic of variance by looking at high frequency data. And it has been documented as displaying significant predictive power for stock market returns. This variance premium is popular. And to some extent, my talk today is a bit to question this popularity. So to be able to do that, as a price to pay, I will not be fully model free. And the key issue will be to accept that we have what I call an exponential affine passing panel with state variables that I'm going to define. And thanks to that, an important parameter that is, I will call leverage effect, and we are going to elaborate. And I will stress that by is often said, in many textbooks, people will tell you, if you want to understand the price of volatility risk, it depends on derivative, because this is basically in this derivative that you will see this price. And this is typically the idea of the VIX, because the VIX is based on derivatives. Okay. I will argue that, by contrast with this general statement, when the leverage is not zero, when there is some leverage effect, the price of volatility risk can be identified even without observation on derivative prices, which kind of at odds with what you can read everywhere in most of the textbooks. I will argue that, on the contrary, when there is leverage effect, the variance premium, by contrast to what is said, does not give you reliable information on the price of volatility risk, because I would argue that you cannot, when there is leverage effect, precisely, you cannot disentangle from the variance premium the price of volatility risk from the price of the risk on the return. The two prices are mixed, and there is an identification issue. So to some extent, it is a win-win strategy if I because on the one hand, when the leverage effect is not zero, the standard tool doesn't work, and I will pretend that I can do it just with option on the return. Of course, this identification story is kind of a miracle, so it is tricky, and you strong. So I will import in functional econometrics, which an option passive, which may be rather new, something which has been popular in econometrics over the last 20 years, which is the concept of weak identification. That is to say, maybe when leverage is close to zero, because we are going to see that the identification of leverage itself is fragile. So when the identification of leverage is fragile, maybe the identification that is supposed to provide may be also fragile. I'm going to do something which try to have a procedure of inference about this price of risk, the confidence interval and so on, which is robust to weak identification. So to say, the confidence interval is going to be wide, if necessary, if identification is weak. And I will base that on a new wave of robustness. Basically, identification comes from where I have transform parameters that estimate directly, like volatility, whatever you want. And then I have these structural parameters for price of risk and leverage that I have to back out from the reduced form parameters. And I have a link function between that. And if the link function is a bit flat, identification becomes an issue. This is the key. So even if I'm going to be interrupted by Tara at some stage, and I'm glad to that, but at least I will have, this is what I want to say. Okay. So, because I have a long outline, so I'm a bit stressed by the timing, but no worries, I will manage. At least I will try to give you a kind of general presentation at the beginning to see the story, and okay, I will go more or less in the details, depending whether I can or not. Okay. I will first introduce what I call a leverage effect preserving change of measure, because leverage effect, as I say, is going to be my key topic of interest. So I will assume variables. To keep it simple, I will just assume there is an asset return, RT, a log return actually, and a volatility factor, sigma t. But if you want to extend it with five volatility factors, I have no issue with that. It is just to keep it simple. I will decide, as it is popular in option pricing, I will say, to characterize the probability distribution of interest by the so-called conditional Laplace transform, the moment generating function. To say that for the historical distribution, you have a joint distribution of R and sigma, which is defined by this function, okay, which is conditional to past information. And I have another function I put, as usual, a star for risk neutral, a risk neutral expectation to define the risk neutral distribution. IT is the conditioning information set, which is going to typically contain the path of these state variables. And since I'm thinking about option pricing on equity, I don't care about about interest rate. So I will basically have a risk-free rate, which is exogenously given, RFT. And basically, you may want to think about my asset return as the log excess return. So you have something like the log of the return on the underlying stock, if you want, in excess of the risk-free rate. This is the way I think about that. Okay. So basically, my tool to work today are going to these two joint distribution, historical and risk neutral. Now, prices of risk. There are going to be two parameters for that. Typically, there is a risk on the return itself and the risk on the volatility of this return. You like high return, right? So the price of risk on return is positive, okay? And you like low volatility, so the price of risk on volatility is negative. And two parameters. I'm not going to impose that in the estimation, but fortunately I will find that on this side, okay? Because this is not what I find, there is something wrong, okay? So these two prices are going to show up in which is called a pricing kernel or a stochastic discount factor. I'm sorry, it's a bit of jargon of option pricing. Please interrupt me if there is some trouble. Basically, what this stochastic discount factor say, it depends on the future of the state variables, on the two price of risk parameters. And basically, it says that the price, if you have a payoff at the end of the period T plus one, which depends on the two state variables, the price of this payoff, okay, is the expectation of the discounted payoff, stochastic discount factor like that. Okay? If you will be risk neutral, the price of the payoff will just be the discounted value of the expected value of the payoff. So you have this correspondence between the two way to price with historical or risk neutral. So far, so good? Okay. And the funny thing is to realize that this relationship, you can write it with all payoff of this form, exponential payoff, which brings you back to the conditional Laplace transform. That is to say, you realize that, and actually the trick will be the following. If you accept, so for the moment, it's going to be my only restrictive assumption. If you accept that the price kernel is exponential of fine with respect to the state variable, which when we manipulate in the day-to-day life of asset pricing are always exponential of fine, you know, coming from consumption-based or whatever. If it's an engine, whatever, all these things are exponential of fine. If you accept the idea that the pricing kernel is exponential of fine, meaning that, you know, you have a part for discounting risk-free, apart from remembering the past, and this is where the covariances with risk is going to matter through the price of entity risk and the price of risk of return. Okay? If you take a guy like that, the great thing is that this exponential is going to mix up with this exponential for the payoff, meaning that these things can be read as the relationship. And basically, this is what you get. You get at the end of the day with a few manipulations that the general link is that when you have the Laplace transform of the risk neutral, you rescale it by the Laplace transform of the historical computed as the price parameter, and you get the Laplace transform of the historical with this translation. So basically, you can go from one way to the other. When you know the risk neutral, you know the historical ensemble through the prices of risk. And of course, it is when the prices of risk are zero that the Laplace transform at zero is one, and you get the identity between L and L star. But of course, you don't expect these prices of risk to be zero. So it's going to be, to some extent, the only assumption I need. After that, of course, to go to the data, I will take some specification of the model. But if you prefer another model, I don't care. As long as you accept to work within this framework. Okay. So what do I call a leverage effect preserving change of measure? You know, we are used when you take change of measure in continuous time, we are used to know that thanks to Gerson-Hopf theorem, the diffusion part does not change, so the leverage effect does not change. In discrete time, you cannot get something like that for reason I'm going to explain a bit later. But at least what I'm going to maintain is the property that there is no historical leverage effect if and only if there is no risk neutral leverage effect. And the reason why it works is precisely to this factorization I gave before. Because leverage effect, I don't know whether you are familiar with this terminology, but of course, leverage is coming from corporate finance, but it is relevant for option pricing, as pointed out by Fisher-Black, 1976, because you have an instantaneous correlation between volatility, between the return and its volatility. So basically, what leverage effect means in my notation, sigma is my volatility factor. I don't say yet it is volatility, but in my volatility factor, leverage effect means that in the conditional distribution, sigma and R are independent. No leverage effect means that. Leverage effect means they are not independent. Okay? So, you know, because we, from the Fisher-Black argument, we know that leverage effect is something meaning that there is kind of negative instantaneous correlation between return and its volatility. Because there is an asymmetry when there is negative return, you expect even more volatility. Does it make sense? Okay. So, leverage effect basically means that the two things are not independent, and no leverage effect means that they are independent, so you can factorize the Laplace transform in a product of two. And you realize, thanks to this identity, that you can factorize this one, if and only if you can factorize this one. So, even though we are in discrete time, we keep the nice thing of Gerson-Hopf theorem, saying there is no leverage effect in the historical, if and only if there is no leverage effect in the risk neutral. And it's going to be the key. This is the reason why this is what I need you to accept in my framework. Why discrete time is an issue for leverage effect? It is something which has been in particular pointed out by these authors. The story is the following. When you are discrete time and you are thinking about correlation between volatility and return, there are two things here. There is a genuine leverage effect, described by Fisher-Black for a reason of corporate finance, you can discuss. And there is something else which is called volatility feedback. What is volatility feedback? The point that since risk is compensated, when volatility is increased, people are asking for more return, and since they're asking for more return, the price is going to be lower. So, you know, these two correlation effects, in continuous time, you are not mixing them, because in continuous time, leverage effect is really something instantaneous, the correlation between the two Brownians, and risk compensation, volatility feedback is a well-defined causality in one direction. When you are in discrete time, everything may come in within the time interval, and you don't disentangle the two. So the argument this author are making is that it takes high-frequency data to be able to disentangle the two. Okay. My passing story is not in high frequency, so I'm, strictly speaking, not able to disentangle the two. Okay? It's going to be the kind of the main difficulty of my modeling story. Okay. So basically, when I will have to go to assess the amount of leverage effect, unfortunately, once more, it is zero on the risk neutral if of leave, zero on the historical. But when I will have to assess the amount of leverage effect, I will have to go to the risk neutral story because they are not polluted by risk compensation. Okay? Because this is, I want to disentangle the two. So I will look at the way when, you know, the story is the following, you know, you have a period TT plus one, and you imagine that you make a forecast, this is fictitious stuff, of course, but given not only the past information, but the current volatility. Because this is the impact of current volatility in this forecast, which is leverage effect, right? There is a connection between return and volatility. So I'm going to use this notation I sigma for this kind of fictitious information where I have added the current value of volatility. And it is to what extent in this forecast sigma t plus one matters, which can tell me the amount of leverage effect with my definition of the parameter phi. Once more, kind of the main challenge of this paper is to be able to work in discrete time with this parameter. Okay. Okay. Now, back to my general story about identification of prices of risk. People pretend they are going to identify prices of risk from the risk neutral from the VIX, so from the risk neutral expectation of the coming variation. You remember the factorization of the Laplace? If you want the Laplace of sigma, sigma is the first variable, so you just have to take V equals zero, and you get the marginal Laplace of the sigma. By this formula, the marginal Laplace of the sigma can be written as this ratio. If you think about the VIX should intuitively, I will be more precise in a few minutes, but something like that, the risk neutral expectation of the coming volatility factor. By the property of the Laplace transform, it is the derivative at zero of this Laplace transform. Coming like that. And what do you instantaneously observe is that, sure, when there is no leverage effect, when there is no leverage effect, you remember the things are factorized. Then you realize that basically LT of psi 2 can be factorized out, canceled out from the numerator and denominator. You get a function of psi 1. So when there is no leverage effect, people are right to think that VIX identifies the price psi 1, I should say zeta 1, sorry, zeta 1 of volatility risk. Okay. But when there is leverage effect, this thing does not factorize out. Everything depends on both zeta 1 and zeta 2. And you will not, in general, be able to disentangle that. So it is misleading to think that you are identifying zeta 1 from that. Okay. So this is my point about impossibility. When there is leverage effect, the standard approach does not work. Okay. Now I have to convince you that my non-standard approach may work. So I regard that as a possibility. So I'm, what is my approach? Is to say, just observing the price of the underlying asset is going to allow me to identify zeta 1 when there is leverage. Why? The pricing equation of the, you remember, RT plus 1 is a net log excess return. So when the risk is not compensated, the risk neutral expectation is just 1. But this is a Laplace transform. This is a Laplace transform computed at minus 1. Okay? So this Laplace transform should be 1. But you remember that the risk neutral Laplace transform is related to the historical this way. So just the price of the underlying asset tell you that these two things should be equal. Sure, if there is no leverage effect, you can factorize the Laplace transform and LT of zeta 1 cancel out. You don't identify zeta 1 from the price of the asset. But when there is leverage effect, this thing cannot be factorized. And so this identity gives you, okay, information about what should be zeta 1. So you could say, okay, but there are two parameters, zeta 1 and zeta 2. But you have to realize that these things are conditional Laplace transform. So they are dynamic functions, depending on several things. So you may hope to have two equations to identify the two parameters. So it is not true, when there is a large effect, that asset return data does not allow to identify zeta 1. It should. I will exemplify that, but it is my kind of general point. Okay. So let me now, so far I've been very careful not to write down any specific model in order to be almost model free. But of course, if I want to go to the details, to make inference and so on, I have to write down a model. Okay, so now I've been a bit more specific. And to do that, I will work not only with an affine pricing kernel, but also with affine dynamics. And for that, I'm going to use affine dynamics as have been introduced by these people, what they call compound autoregressive. Okay, so the idea is that you have something like an autoregression when you look at exponential. If you use the properties of the Laplace transform, you get the expectation, the variance, and so on by derivatives at zero. You realize the following. You realize that this tells you that number one, the volatility is kind of an autoregressive for the one process, this volatility factor. Okay, you forecast it by the fine function, which is, in passing the case of conditional variance with Garch, for instance, it is conformable to that. And the conditional variance is also fine, which is the case of all these popular models like Cox-Ingersoll-Ross, Eston, Duffy-Pan, Singleton, and so on. You may know that this affine model have sometimes been criticized by not so goodness of fit to real data, but you have to remember that this model are continuous time. Continuous time is much more constraining because when you give me the drift and the diffusion, you give me everything. In discrete time, I have much more freedom to put all the fat tails you dream of or whatever. So the criticism against a fine model may not hold, okay? But anyway. So same thing for the return dynamics. What I do, you know, I have just defined the distribution of sigma t plus 1 given the past. To factorize the joint distribution, I'm not going to now to define the distribution of rt plus 1 given the past and sigma t plus 1. In factorizing the distribution, the joint distribution. I've taken also exponential affine. In passing, what I will go when I will go to the data, but otherwise I don't need it. Assuming that the return is conditionally log normal, so the log return is conditionally normal, given past information and current volatility, amounts to assume that this function alpha, beta, gamma are quadratic. To get the Laplace transform of normal distribution. You have to realize that it's not so restrictive because it is even not the conditional distribution of return given the past. It's the conditional distribution of return given the past and the current volatility. So when you integrate out, you can have all the fat tails you dream of, okay? But, and moreover, I'm not obliged to, but if I may assume, and I will go to the data with that, assuming that alpha, beta, gamma are quadratic. So I have conditional normality. Again, by the standard formula, you have the conditional expectation and the conditional variance given this information, which is augmented by the current volatility. So, I end up with joint return volatility dynamics which are fine like that. Something you may know, but in that I'm relatively conformable, I think, to the literature on option pricing, is that The joint distribution of both volatility and return depend only on past volatility. What does it mean? It means that past volatility, the volatility factor is Markov, which is standard for state variables. And it is Markov, and it is not grandeur caused by the return. That is to say, not only it is Markov, but even jointly with the return, you don't need the return in the conditioning information. And on top of that, if you think, given the volatility pass, the return becomes serially independent. You know, it does not depend on the past anymore. But assuming that all the dynamics in the returns come through the volatility factor is relatively standard assumption, right? So, you may, as you want, but it's not completely analogous. Okay, now, the nice thing also with this thing is that when I will change of measure, I will not change the structure of the model, because basically I had some A and B function for volatility. I had some A star, B star, I had some alpha, beta, gamma function for return. When I go to the risk neutral, I have some A star and B star, and alpha star, beta star, gamma star. And you can see they are just related like that. That is to say, so, I had written that it is a nice property of the model that the change of measure is model preserving. I have been criticized by a referee saying it's a lack of flexibility because you are, okay, fair enough, but I would say it is a structural model, right? So if I believe in some pattern for the dynamics, I have the same pattern in historical and it's neutral, just changing the parameters. And the way the parameters are changing is that, remember, this is about the dynamics of the return. The way they are changing is only through the price zeta 2 on the risk on the return. And now when you look at the dynamics of the volatility, the way it is changing is through not only the price zeta 2 of the dynamics of the return, but also on the price zeta 1 of the dynamics of the price of volatility risk. This is actually the reason why people believe that they need option price data, because option price data is the only way to observe the price of volatility risk. And since zeta 1 shows up only here, they believe that they need option price data to make it. And my argument, it is not true. Actually, it is even worse than that. When there is leverage, and maybe I should have mentioned that before, you know, when you look at this transformation, it shows you that leverage, that is to say, C by T plus 1 matters, when the function alpha is not zero. The function alpha being not zero, it is exactly saying there is leverage. Okay, that's an instantaneous correlation. Okay? And actually, when there is leverage, you see that the two are mixed here through the function alpha. And it is precisely my problem. The variance risk premium will not make it due to this interconnection. Okay. Just a quick technical remark. So far, I have not said what was the volatility factor. But I have implicitly assumed that I'm going to observe it. There's a payoff function of it and so on. So to make that, I'm going to assume this connection between the two things. So far, I have nothing telling me that sigma is the volatility of R. Okay? So I will maintain this condition. It is easy to maintain. I just have to assume some constraint of my function beta and gamma. Okay, this constraint. Why do I do that? Because in continuous time model, general people overlook the with high frequency data, they overlook the randomness of the drift, and they will basically say that, you know, what people used to say is that the conditional variance of the daily return is the expectation at the beginning of the day of the integrated variance. So basically maintaining this condition allows me to interpret this guy, this volatility factor that I introduced from the beginning, as a continuous time integrated variance. Volatility drift, if you want. I don't know how you want to call it. Okay? This is what people do in general, right? So, thanks to that, with high frequency data, I will be able to estimate this integral, right? Typically, the standard quadratic variation. And thanks to this quadratic variation, I will pretend that I observe the volatility factor. You may find it too restrictive. In the first paper I mentioned, which is forthcoming, we are more general. Basically, we accept that the variance is actually only in a fine function like that. We give us more freedom. And the advantage of that approach is that then even though my volatility factor is Markov, is autoregressive for the one, the integrated variance is going to be Arma 1-1, which is a more popular model and better goodness of fit model for integrated variance. So you can do that if you want. It's sort of that since I set the focus on this paper on identification, I have decided to keep it simple. But in the other paper, we do that. Okay. Okay, so variance premium and leverage, as I say, it will not work because typically now that I understood the conditional variance at time t is defined like that, when I make the difference, this is with the Riesz-Knott rule, but with the historical. As I said a minute ago, when the function alpha is not zero, when there is leverage, the two parameters are mixed together. So you cannot identify zeta 1 from the variance risk premium. By contrast, when you go with return data, you remember my story from the pricing equation of the underlying asset. Sorry, maybe too many equations on this slide, but at the end of the day, you realize that you have two equations to identify the two prices of risk. And the reason for that, right, is that basically, when you take an expectation given IT, it is a function of sigma, a fine function of sigma t. So you have the constant coefficient and the coefficient of sigma t, so you have two coefficients to identify by the pricing restriction, the two prices of risk, zeta 1 and zeta 2. Okay. So basically, when I say I will have to address some identification weakness issue, is this information overly flat, I would say, that it's hard to solve it for the two parameters. This is the question. Okay. To address that, I will go a bit further in the modeling. Basically, what I'm going to use is what I will call a discrete time Eston model. That is to say, as I told you, if I want to assess the amount of leverage, I will work with the risk control expectation. So I will call leverage this parameter, which is negative, which tells me how there is a negative risk neutral instantaneous correlation between volatility and return. This guy I call leverage. Now, if I want to go to the historical, I have a relation between the two, you remember? And if I write down the relation, I have no time to go too much into the details, but if you believe that this guy is leverage, but historical, you realize that you actually underestimate leverage. Why? Due to the volatility feedback. How you can see that in this equation? You have this leverage, which is supposed to be negative, but you have this part, which is actually positive when you think about it, and it is precisely zeta 2, remember, it is the price of risk on return. So it is precisely the risk compensation on return, which adds some positive component, meaning that you will underestimate how much leverage is negative, if you look at the historical. Okay, I have no much time to show you something which actually not in this paper, but it's a way to think about it. Some work I've done before, a long time ago actually, with Liz Artusi, on the impact of stochastic volatility on the volatility smile. What we had shown with Liz Artusi was that since when you price with stochastic volatility, you can more or less see the option price as an expectation of Black and Scholes, where in Black and Scholes you put the random into volatility on the period to come. There's a kind of Janssen effect, leading what was popular as the so-called volatility smile, meaning that when you look at the implied volatility, Black-Scholes implied volatility as a function of the moneyness, you have a U-shaped curve with a minimum at the money, and the curve is symmetric. This is often you don't observe that, actually. What we have shown with Liz Artusi is that with this works when there is no leverage effect. Because when there is no leverage effect, basically you are mixing normals, but with always the same mean. So you don't introduce any asymmetry, and you end up with your symmetric volatility smile. What we have shown more recently is that when there is leverage effect, that is to say, in the conditional mean, you still have the current volatility which shows up. It does not belong to IT, but only to IT sigma. Now you are mixing normals with different means. And we all know that we are mixing normal with different means, we produce some asymmetry. And the smile is not going to be asymmetric anymore. And you can show that actually it is steeply increasing on the out of the money side, okay? And so it gives you the kind of smirk, okay, that people have described, okay? It's give me, well, I did not know when preparing this talk that Yassine would be in the room, so I did not add that in the, in the slide, I gave my slide before meeting you yesterday. Yassine has a nice paper about the so-called leverage effect puzzle, and correct me if I am wrong, Yassine, but at the very beginning you say, everybody knows that leverage does exist, and it is hard to identify. Okay? I refer to your work here because, number one, I need to stress that identification of leverage itself is fragile, so everything is going to be fragile. And to some extent, when you observe an asymmetric volatility smile, if there is no any other market friction or whatever, it is a proof that there is some leverage effect, even if you have hard time to estimate it with discrete time data. Okay. So this is a connection with Yassine works. Okay, now to go further in the parametric model, I'm going to use what I'm going to say, an autoregressive gamma, which has been introduced by Goryeo and Jasiak. Basically, they take specific function for the dynamics of volatility, meaning that in this case, the transition properties are mixture of gamma. So basically, you can show, we have shown in the forthcoming paper, that the continuous time limit of that is the Heston model. Because in the Heston model, you know, you have this also gamma transition. So it's really, you can really see that at a discrete time Heston model. And then the link function telling you how you should identify the prices of risk can be written like that. So basically what you see is that this is going to allow you to identify zeta 1 and zeta 2. You will have two equations insofar as leverage is not zero. If leverage is not zero, you have two equations, right? Because the second equation becomes tricky. Okay, so all the question is, okay, how flat are the square of this equation as function of zeta 1 and zeta 2? And your leverage is basically that. How much time left I have time?
About 7 minutes.
7 minutes, okay. So I'm afraid I will have to speed up. Okay, the last thing I have to address is how to measure leverage effect in discrete time, as I said, it's difficult because basically it is showing up in two places, in the expectation and in the variance, if I'm looking at the first 2 moments. And this has the flavor of what we are used to in continuous time, right? In continuous time, when you have two equations like that, you define leverage as a parameter which is a correlation between the two Brownian. You expect it to be minus 1 and 0. And what is the impact of that? You can decompose this Brownian as the Brownian in volatility plus an orthogonal part, meaning that if you think about conditioning by the volatility path, basically what we did with 2Z, you say, I have stochastic volatility, but I think about conditioning by the volatility path. You have two effects. Since you are conditioning, you reduce the variance. And you reduce the variance by the residual variance due to this correlation. But you have another impact, is that you put something in the drift. Something is known now, given the volatility path. So you have to think about the leverage effect parameter phi, which leads to variance reduction, like that, and to drift from that like that. And so basically, this is the part of the slide I'm going to skip. Phi should enter this and this, in a way to give you, to correspond to this continuous time intuition. And to take into account the volatility feedback in discrete time. So all these things mixing together will take me 15 minutes to present, so I'm going to save this time, and to jump on that. And
what?
Okay. Now I am in business. Okay. Okay, so let me put it this way. Sorry, I'm still jumping, I will come back. Okay. I have what I call link function, meaning the following. I have reduced form parameters that I can estimate easily from the data by GML. I have moment conditions. If I have a few minutes left, I will come back, but by moment conditions. These reduced form parameters, I denote them by omega. Omega, you may remember, this is the volatility dynamics with this gamma model. And this is the return dynamics, okay? And the xi is maybe look weird, but I have a xi which is a reduced form parameter, And in terms of structural parameters, it's 1 minus phi squared. So you may wonder why I introduced two different parameters, but the point is psi, I can estimate it directly. If I want to estimate phi, number one, I have a square root, you know, and so if the leverage is close to zero, you know, these are the issue of parameters on the boundary, it is not asymptotically normal, and so on. So identification of phi is fragile. And now I have the other equation, which is also about phi, but for the mean part with the volatility feedback. And I have these two equations which come from the pricing of the underlying asset return. So I end up with 4 link functions depending on the reduced form parameters and the 3 structural parameters, the 2 prices of risk and the leverage effect parameter. The 3 guys for which identification is tricky. So basically, as I said, I have skipped the slide, but I guess you can believe me that all these reduced form parameters are easy to estimate by GML. And because I have normal condition for everything, and by the standard formula of GMM, I know there are asymptotic variance, and so I am in business. Now the problem is to invert these 4 equations to get back the structural parameters. But identification may be weak. So what I'm going to do? I'm going to say, this is my link function, let me introduce the estimated structural, the true estimated reduced form, the true reduced form. Okay, the Jacobian matrix as usual. Okay, delta theorem as usual. I know the asymptotic description like that. So I have a minimum distance problem. The efficient minimum distance estimator will be defined like that. You may already notice that I do something which is not fully standard. Instead of doing a two-step approach, I put theta itself here, meaning that I'm doing the minimum distance analog of continuity of the TGMM. I let the theta free in the variance. This is not a two-step procedure where you step, first step estimator and then you use the quadratic form. It has been known now in the weak identification literature that when the identification is weak, you don't want to use a crazy first step estimator because you don't know. And so it is much better behaved because of a generalization of Anderson and Rubin, which has been studied by Stock and White and others, to write it like that. It is more robust to weak identification. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Eric.
No, 5 minutes, she told me. I was completely scared. Anyway.
We have a communication.
Because, you know, for those of you who are not so excited with finance and more interested with econometric methodology, it is now, okay? So, okay. So about econometric methodology, what we do is basically we make an extension to minimum distance of a procedure which has been put forward recently by Andrews and Mikosheva for GMM. Okay? That is to say, how to do, once more, the simple fact that we put theta here is already a kind of robustification against weak identification. For GMM, it has been done by Klebergen, and for minimum distance, it has been done by his former student, Leandro Magnusson. Okay. Now, we want to go even further to apply the trick that Andrews and Mikusheva put on the table for GMM to apply it for distance. And basically, what we do is the following. You know, we do a quasi-likelihood ratio approach. This is to say, it is known that when there is weak identification, likelihood may be, either it is not likelihood, but it is an objective function. This objective function may be flat. And so to get rid of weak identification, the trick is to rather estimate by inverting a test based on this likelihood function or this objective function. So basically, you write down this quasi-likelihood ratio where you say, if my testing value, theta zero with an upper index is the true value, but with a lower index is the tested value. I want to test whether theta is equal to theta zero. I will look at something like a likelihood ratio. The value of the objective function theta zero, the constraint one minus the unconstrained minimum one. And basically, I will keep theta zero if this likelihood ratio is not larger than some threshold. And basically, at the end of the day, my confidence set will be all the theta zero which will pass the test. So this is very standard way to address weak identification. The question is that you have no idea what is the threshold value you should use. And it is actually the contribution of Andrews and Mikosheva to tell you how to devise the Monte Carlo procedure to estimate this critical value. And the reason why it works is that, so it's going to be maybe a bit technical for the last word, so I'm just going to give to sketch it. The reason why it works is that basically when people think about quick identification, they mean that this g of theta, which should be non-zero at the, should be zero at the true value and not zero everywhere else, is actually so close to zero that maybe even if you multiply by square root of t, the limit is finite, it's not infinite. It is typically the way Steger and Stock, Stock and White, and so on have defined weak identification. So meaning that you have actually a functional central limit theorem for all theta of the empirical process. And thanks to this asymptotic normality, I have not much time to go into the details, but basically you can think about the residual of the regression on the estimated g at theta minus, you make the regression of this on the guy at theta naught. This is the regression equation, right? The covariance and the inverse of the variance. The great thing with normality is that when you make a regression, the error term of the regression is independent of the exponential variables. Meaning that at the end of the day, to simulate my critical value, I will be able to take advantage that this rest is independent of this part because it is a regression. Meaning that the only thing I have to do, I will simulate in that, I will compute this guy, this simulated guy like that, and I will get simulated value of my likelihood ratio like that. I can build how many simulated values I want, so meaning that I can have a Monte Carlo computation of the threshold. So I can run my test. And in my last minute, thank you, Tara, I'm going to give you the result, what I find. Okay. For leverage, okay, I find something negative, maybe the model is a bit too much, too restrictive, as I say, I make a restriction by assuming that the iterated volatility was R1 instead of R-1. So I would have liked to find it more negative than that, but okay, it's okay, confidence interval. The point I want to make is, these are the confidence interval for the price of volatility risk and the price of risk and return. Number one, there are the good sign, you know, one is positive, the other one is negative. Number two, for the price of the risk and return, you have decent identification. And obviously, for the price of volatility risk, identification is weak, right? The confidence interval is large. So you may say, well, I have done all of that to end up with, okay. But at least I had a claim that I was able to do it, I have made it, okay? Of course, if you use option price data, you will much improve the accuracy, but using option price data means that you trust an option pricing model and so on, what I did not do, okay? No, anyway, just to by sake of comparison with the forthcoming paper, George Metrics, the former paper we had before, we have used option price data. And we have found for zeta 1 this value with the standard error of that, so of course the confidence interval was much narrow, but because we had used option price data, okay? And, you know, the model was slightly different, so you cannot completely compare this result, but okay, they have some order of magnitude you may want to compare. The parameters do not change that much, but of course the width of the confidence interval for zeta 1 has changed a lot. Okay, so just to conclude, Tara, thank you. I'm not even not going to slide, just to let it here. we have tried to, I'll say two words. We have tried to bring two things. One for financial econometrics, this identification issue, wearables in very general circumstances to identify the price of volatility risk. When there is a regression, when you think about it, everybody say you need option price data because it is this price which gives you the price of volatility risk. But when there is leverage effect is precisely bridging the two, and meaning that it is not so surprising that we can make it. Okay? And there are some sort of econometric methodologies that even if you don't like finance, the last thing I did, you can use in other context. You know, Magnusson had used that for limited dependent variable models, the analog of continuous stability GMM, and you could go one step farther by doing what we did. Okay, thank you, Tom.
we have time for questions. The way it goes is that there are, because we're taping, there are some microphones, so if you, before asking your question, I beg if you put up your hand and then the person will bring a microphone to you. So, any questions? No question? You seen you're not going to ask a question?
So my question is more about, so what make you, what makes you think that the two parameters are identified in the same direction? So why don't you look at your previous work where the two moment conditions inside can actually converge at different rates of convergence? So I think.
Ah, okay. You know, you refer to some work I've done with Bertie Antoine where we have worked typically on what we call Norley strong or Norley weak identification, because, you know, I was extreme enough, you know, what I had shown you before, to assume that for any theta, this guy is so flat around zero that even multiplied by square root of t, it has a finite limit. Okay. What I've done with Bertie, what we call Norley strong or Norley weak identification, is that, you know, instead of putting square root of t, we put a power of t between 0 and 1 half, meaning that there is some weakness identification, but not complete weakness. So this is a very good point. We could try to check whether it is more relevant in this framework. We did not, because, you know, I don't know why we did not, because actually, you may have noticed that one of my co-authors of this paper is Zhushan from UPenn, and with Don Andrews, I have a paper exactly also on Norley weak and Norley strong. So to some extent, we are a bit schizophrenic. We should have worked on that. You are absolutely right. What would it deliver? I'm not sure. To be what you are saying, just to conclude a bit, but what I understand, tell me if you agree with me. What you are saying, maybe we are overly pessimistic about identification strengths.
Yes.
And maybe we could have delivered a confidence interval less wide.
Like more efficient.
Okay, yes.
So what I mean is, I don't think identification is so weak because none of the confidence interval is actually minus infinite plus infinite.
Sure.
It is likely some of these parameters are...
No, this is a very good point. I have two things that can be done, but to be sure, we have been maybe overly robust. We could be a bit more...
A little bit conservative.
Thank you for that. Microphone
over here, please.
Thanks so much. I just wanted to know, we have a lot of data also, not just option pricing, which you haven't considered. As far as I could tell. But also, we have many securities nowadays.
Sure.
Right?
Now, yeah, it was just about Standard & Poor's, right? But no, you're right.
I'm just saying, but in a way, you may be too pessimistic, not because of your methodology, which was discussed, but I think because there are so many other data in a panels type context one could use, because of throughout volatility, doesn't affect the market, affects the constituents of the market or all the other securities. In my own experience is that actually it is trying to find out sort of whether there are other assets which has you know, some impact from volatility such that you can use like an implicit in your answer, whether you could extend this analysis.
No, of course, Sacha, I fully agree with you. I also think that we could have a more sophisticated model with the short-run component and long-run component in volatility and so on. A lot of things could be done to improve the model. I'm not, I would say the motivation of this talk is not to tell you what you should do to estimate option pricing model. It's just to tell you good news, and the only people I know who have met relatively recently are Bondy and Reno, working on high-frequency data. Good news, once there is leverage, you know, asset returns are informative also about the price of the volatility risk. But after that, using this information is an optimal way. I'm very far from that for the two reasons which I put it. Thank you, yes.
Any more questions? Then let's thank Eric.
Break now for about half an hour, and please think about writing notes to Marty's family. There'll be paper and pens over by the coffee break area.
Thank you.
And come back here at 11. Thank you.